His new album, Faith in the Future, I got it right here with me, comes out tomorrow, tonight at midnight. He's playing Irving Plaza here in New York tomorrow as well on the release day. And he's just announced today, as I'm sure you know, his 2023 tour. Please, everybody, welcome Louis Tomlinson. Louis.
Hello, mate. How are you doing?
Good. How are you doing today?
Yeah, good. Thanks. I'm good. I'm excited.
Yeah, I bet. You've had so many things happen to you, I think, in the last 24 hours, from the tour announcement to the album coming out tomorrow. How have you been recently?
Great, man. Yeah, it's all kind of coming together. I only finished my tour this year relatively recently, but... Yeah, it's my favorite thing to do, touring, man. So I wanted to get out as quick as I could. But also, you know, releasing the album tomorrow, I started this year's tour with that album. I knew what all the songs were, but obviously I wasn't playing them. So it's a nice feeling to now finally release, definitely.
Yeah, like I think this album's been in your radar for quite a while. I believe I heard you talk about it, that it's been in process for 9 months and you've kind of had it on your back for 9 months. How did that feel playing those concerts this year with the album coming up? And were you like, I really want to show you this stuff, but I can't yet? Or what was around that?
Well, I'd been waiting for those kind of tour moments for a long time. That was always my favorite thing to do in the band. So once I'd finally got on tour, like, that's all I was kind of thinking about, the fact that I was here now and really, really enjoying the shows. But I'd be lying if, you know, in the back of my mind, I was excited, thinking, you know, if this tour with this album feels this good, I'm really excited for the next one. Because this album, the new album, Faith in the Future, it's been written with the tour in mind on every single song. So I'm crossing my fingers and hoping this will be a better tour, I think.
Yeah, I was wondering that. When you made these songs on Faith in the Future, did you look towards your performance of these songs? Or have you ever maybe pictured yourself playing these songs live and how that would go and how they would flow through the show already?
Yeah, well, I was lucky enough before lockdown, I had two tour shows, and then it got postponed. But it meant that when I went into writing, those two shows were very, very fresh in my mind. So, you know, I didn't have to imagine too hard, really. And it was just about trying to create these kind of moments of excitement, because where I'm lucky is the crowds are absolutely amazing for me, honestly, at every single show. So I wanted a record that kind of met them in the middle with that kind of energy, really.
Sure, and match their energy same level, right? Now, you talked about writing a little bit. Tell me more about, for this particular album, for Faith in the Future, when you sat down to write it, what was in your mind, really? What was your goal in mind? Did you have a set thing for yourself that you wanted to write more music, or did you just end up having written music at the end of the day?
I had a vague idea. I mean, the good thing about lockdown for me, it gave me time and gave me clarity to kind of work out exactly what it is I wanted out of this record, what I wanted it to sound like, what I wanted it to feel like. So for me, again, the live show was at the forefront of my mind, and that helped me. You know, for example, we're going in a session one day and I've got a song called The Greatest, and that was written as a tour opener. And it was just about trying to create as many of these moments as possible, really. But when I listened back to this album, it is kind of how I imagined it, but a little bit better, really. I feel really, really good about it. Because, you know what it's like when you're speculating about something. Sometimes self-doubt will creep in and you're wondering what it's going to turn out like. But now, looking back and listening back to those songs, I'm immensely proud, definitely.
Yeah, that's incredible, too. I feel like when you're thinking about an album or when you're thinking about songs, it just kind of sits there in your mind, right? But then when you actually carry it out and practice it, and get it recorded and get it done. To look back on that, have you been listening to this album a lot after you finished it?
I have, actually, and I'm not going to lie, it's not really something I've done a lot in the past in terms of listening to my own music a lot, but I really like this album, so I've been listening to it quite a lot. It's more in line with the kind of stuff that I like listening to anyway, so, you know, it's kind of natural, I suppose, that I'll be listening to it a bit more.
Having finished this album for a little while, do you still write from time to time? Are you the kind of person that likes to write every day, or are you more kind of intentional about the time that you spend writing usually?
A little bit of both. I mean, there's you know, every other day I might be writing on my phone concepts or lyrics or song titles. Right. But in terms of, like, really getting into writing a full song, it's been so busy at the moment, you know, I haven't really had time, because you need to have space in your brain to be creative. So there's little moments in the car, like I said, where I'll write a few lyrics or I'll write a title or whatever. But in terms of getting into the proper songwriting, I feel like I need to get this year out of the way and then really start with that.
Oh, that's really interesting. So you're an artist, would you say, that needs that space to kind of take to yourself and spend some time by yourself and really flesh things out?
Yeah, because, you know, it's important, especially because you're writing about life experience a lot of the time. And, you know, you have to go and experience life to be able to write about
this
that.
This is true.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Oh, so yeah, you do need that space. I think every creative really needs that space in the brain to be able to just have that fluidity that you need when you're creative.
When you talk about those life experiences, obviously you kind of made the connection between seeing your fans live at the show and then writing for moments like that. Has a lot of that happened since you've been on tour this year? Have you been kind of inspired to make more and do more and be better as well?
Massively. You know, both kind of inspired by the crowd and thinking to the next record and thinking, you know, I'll probably do a similar thing where it is kind of built around those live experiences, but also kind of reinforced the fact that I made Faith in the Future for that reason. I was going through that tour this year, watching how amazing the crowds were and thinking, well, I think I've done right to make this album kind of centered around these moments. Because as a music fan, you know, everyone can relate to this. I love listening to the CDs, don't get me wrong, or however people do the music these days. But for me, it's about the live moments. They're the moments that really stick in your memory.
Have you ever thought about doing a live album for yourself? I feel like that would go so well with like the electricity that you bring and the crowds that you bring. I feel like it would be really contagious.
Yeah, I would be up for doing that. I did a live version of one of my singles recently. But yeah, that'd be cool. That'd be cool. It also gives the fans an opportunity. You know, if they've been at that show, it's kind of special for them that we've got a recording from there. So yeah, I would like to do something like that.
Yeah, I'm sure a lot of your fans have kind of researched this information, but about Faith in the Future as an album title, can you just tell me a little bit about what it really means to you and what you really take with that as you continue in your musical journey?
I'd say I'm a pretty optimistic person in general. And I wanted the album, for a start, the first record had a little bit too much weight to it emotionally, in my opinion. And I wanted to move away from that with this record. I wanted it to feel hopeful. From the first time you see the title, it inspires a certain feeling, hope, whatever you want to call it. And I think the record kind of, the songs on the record sound hopeful as well. So, you know, it matches who I am as a person. It matches the sound of the record. It's a pretty cool phrase, I think.
Yeah, I think so too. And you mentioned walls briefly. How does Walls relate to this album in which way? Do you see it kind of as like a journey that you were in that sort of space then and now you're in this sort of space? How does it read for you?
Yeah, I wouldn't have been able to get to Faith in the Future without Walls.
Sure.
And I think that's kind of been the way that I've worked in my career today. You know, there's moments where I have kind of evolved. I started off with making like my first single was like a pop dance hybrid.
Yeah, right. Was that with Steve Aoki?
With Steve Aoki
on that as well, right?
He's a legend, man. He's
yeah, I know.
And although that wasn't really who I was as an artist, I had to go through those experiences to understand that, because there was a long stage for me, and even while making Walls, where I still felt like I was developing and I was working out exactly who I was as an artist, you know, just doing it in the public forum, really.
Yeah.
So now with Faith in the Future, I just, from the off, I had a very clear picture. Whereas when I listen back to Walls, in terms of the identity with the album, it's a little bit confused at times. I think there was moments where I could have been braver, and I kind of took that on with Faith in the Future and thought, well, if I'm going to do this and follow my heart, then, you know, I might as well go all in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that comes with the territory, because, you know, as much as I'm sure you have a great idea of who you are as a person, I think like having an idea of who you are as an artist is a whole nother step, right?
Definitely. Mm-hmm. I mean, the two do relate to each other, but at the same time, it is a very different question. You know, you can, and the thing is for me, you know, I'm 30, about to be 31. I've got a pretty good grasp on who I am as a person.
Yeah.
But as an artist, as a solo artist, you know, it still feels relatively new for me. So there was always going to be that element of discovery.
Mm-hmm. For your album process, did you surround yourself with anybody during the process, whether it be a producer or somebody, a friend or anybody that kind of helped you either through the album, not necessarily helped you write it or anything, but just kind of was there present during the creation of it, you think?
I mean, other than being forever influenced by the fans and those live moments. It was the people that I was working with that really helped inspire and made me feel more confident about the music I was making. In general, with this record, I tried to work with more artists, and I think that kind of shows in the album, because there's a different kind of attention to detail that you get with artists. And it was just, you know, to be around those people, even just to hear them talk music like how I talk football, like proper inspiring, inspiring. So just to be around the right people, being in the right rooms, I think, yeah, been a massive benefit to me as a songwriter and an artist.
Tell me about those days that you spent working on the album. Really, did you have a routine every day? How did they go? Did you walk in with something every day, or did you think of something in the studio once in a while?
Well, I wanted to gain a bit of momentum, because what was frustrating for me with Walls is I wrote it over quite a long period of time, and there wasn't really any momentum with sessions. You know, I'd do a couple here, a couple there. So it was important for me to kind of build up these relationships with different writers and different artists. And sometimes when you go in the studio and, like, say you've got to get there at, like, I was going to say 9, but I'm rarely out of bed by that time. If you've got to get, you know, to a studio at, like, midday, and you know you're working till, like, 5 or 6, those time restraints do something to the creation. It definitely does something to the creative, you know, feeling that you have in those moments. So something I did a little bit differently this time around is we just rent a house. And just like, so we'd have like 4 days to write. And it just meant that you had that fluidity where, you know, whenever you felt like writing, you would write instead of trying to force those moments.
Right. And there's also that direction there. I feel like that brings a more maybe focused environment as well. So when you do want to write, you're surrounded by people who want to write with you. And
exactly.
Be there with you,
exactly.
Right?
And also, you know, once you've been in a space like that, when we rent a house, you know, it's even the social moments when you're not writing that are, of course, relevant to then the songs that you go on to write. So it was a much better working environment for me.
Yeah. You know, on the subject of writing, I had a lot of great people watching right now. A lot of people really happy to see you. I did get a really good question from somebody in the chat in regards to your writing. So when you start to write, what do you really start with? You mentioned a bit before about scribbling down maybe a concept or like a lyric somewhere, but where does a song really start for you usually?
For me, it's a very general, sometimes a little bit vague, but it's an idea of the concept of the song, basically, is the bottom line. Sometimes I'll have a little bit more than that, but I normally go into the session with, you know, here's a concept, here's something I've been thinking about recently, can we turn it into a song? And then for me, my strength is in lyric, not necessarily in melody. So once we've kind of got the concept and we realize what we want to talk about, then people start firing different melody ideas, and then we'll put a lyric to it. But I normally go in with a relatively clear picture of what I want to say. It's just not that specific, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And for the singles that you chose for the album coming out, for Out of My System and for Silver Tongues, for those specific songs, what was so special about them to you that you decided to release them before the album came out and you wanted them to be out for the people before the album?
Well, for a start, that's probably my two favorite songs on the album. Uh-huh. And as I said before, this song was written for the live moments. I speculate that those two songs might be the best two songs to play live. Mm. And also, I think it's a good advert of the direction I'm trying to go into, you know, because it was important for me to have a big kind of first look with Bigger Than Me that's got that kind of big sing-along soaring chorus. But then the next two singles for me were more about, not necessarily about, you know, commercial success, more about kind of showing where I'm going musically.
Yeah. Absolutely. Another fan question that caught my eye was about the potential of Easter eggs on the album. Do you think that there's any, or did you plant any Easter eggs or hidden meanings or things like that on the album? I think everyone wants to know.
I don't think so. Other than occasionally writing metaphorically, I mean, I suppose that could be called an Easter egg of some sort. And we normally do those kind of things around like the marketing and around like the run up to an album. So, you know, there'll be some kind of code that the fans will have to decipher, and they're pretty good at it. Uh-huh. But in terms of the lyrics, I kind of write in two ways, either direct, kind of honest from the heart, or metaphorically. But it's not as if like I'm hiding stuff in the lyrics, because... Yeah, I mean, I suppose that's what a metaphor is anyway, right?
I guess so, yeah. It's a device, a literary device, right? So one more thing about your previous work, about Walls or the singles that you released before Walls. Have you ever desired to change anything about those works, listening to them years later? Or do you think that, you know, it's just part of the journey?
I think it is part of the journey, but more recently, I think for maybe the first half of my tour this year, I did do the Steve song. We did this kind of band version, so it sits in line with the rest of the stuff that was playing, which was cool to do. And sometimes I'll do that with One Direction songs as well, kind of reshape them and make them kind of more relevant to the sounds that I'm making now.
Oh, yeah.
That's fun, man. That's exciting to do.
Yeah, that's really exciting to, like, take a song that you thought you knew, I guess, right? And take it and then mix it and then make it fit your life currently, right?
Yeah, yeah. And I think it's fun for the fans. You know, you get a very literal example of this is where I was and this is where I am.
Yeah, absolutely. Speaking of where you are right now, as a father, I'm wondering, your son, does he enjoy your music? Does he, and maybe to get to a more critical question, maybe what does he think about his dad being Louis Tomlinson, like a famous musician?
Well, it's something that I think is difficult for a child his age to understand, obviously. And I can remember going through it with my younger sisters when I was first in the band. I think there is a time in kids' lives where they actually just think that's normal. That, you know, that I'm sure my Freddy, before he saw me live, kind of thought that maybe he's got a couple of mates whose dad's also a singer, which he may well.
Yeah,
he lives in LA.
Because that's
probably
his
is.
Reality, right? Yeah.
But yeah. And for me, it was the moment that he came to watch me at the LA show that I think every story that I told him, you know, kind of made sense because he saw it very literally. And it was dead sweet, man. He came with like a banner and he stayed up like throughout the whole thing. Like, and I got really emotional, man. It was like, it was lovely. Is he into me music? Yes. Thank God he is.
That's good.
Yeah. Because if, oh my God.
Good taste.
If
good
I
taste.
Played him my new single and he's like, I don't like it, I would die inside, man. So luckily.
I think something else I wanted to know about you, Louis, is about your confidence. Because, you know, I feel like it's changed throughout your career. And right now, do you think it's grown into a new shape for you recently?
Yeah, I think there's an element of the fan base giving me this feeling of being fearless, to be honest.
Yeah.
Because I've said before, you know, there's a lot of... There's definitely room for worry when you take a shift in sound from album one and album two. And, you know, in the back of my mind, I'm crossing my fingers. But at the same time, I feel so lucky to have a fan base that allows me to do what I want to do. And that the bottom line is that's why I've had the confidence to make Faith in the Future, because I feel confident that the fans are going to embrace it. And I think, you know, like anything, confidence grows as time goes on. When I first started my career, I wasn't very confident, to be honest. I didn't really know what to do. Whereas now, I feel like I really understand who I am as an artist. You know, as I said, really love my tour shows. Feel like I've worked really well on that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I feel in a good place, man, definitely.
Absolutely. There have been some fans asking me to ask you about 369.
Mm.
Could you tell me a bit about that?
No, absolutely nothing. I enjoy the mystery, so no, I won't.
Very good. Yeah. Another Easter egg for everybody out there. Mm-hmm, there it is.
There you go.
Right?
There it
That's
is.
The
there
Easter
it
egg.
Is,
we
yeah.
found it. Now, you spoke a bit about touring and concerts and whatnot. Now, in your performance, also, I feel like you've grown so much in your performance style and how you work a crowd and how you get out there every time. Nowadays, when you perform, what really runs through your head before you perform?
Listen, before every show, there's an element of nerves.
Sure.
Nerves or excitement, very similar feeling, really. You know, you take, for me, pretty much the whole first song or just at the end of it, you still kind of acclimatize into the crazy environment that you've just walked into.
Yeah.
But for me, I think, you know, when I first started doing like live performances on my own, one thing that I realized straight away is how big the stage is when you're not in a band.
Oh,
you know
yeah.
what I mean? And I'm pretty unfit, man. So I just like stay glued to my mic stand the whole time. Whereas as I got more confident and the energy of the shows, it's it, it's just impossible to stay there. It's impossible to not kind of be led by this incredible energy that you see at these shows. So it's pretty natural, really. It's, you know, there's never a I'm not thinking about going on the left-hand side of the stage at this part and going on the right-hand side at this part. It's all just kind of led by instinct and going off the crowd's energy.
That's really good. Yeah, to be able to match up with that energy is really important, I feel, yeah, like for artists that perform too. And of course, we spoke before, but you just announced a huge tour for next year, and you'll be going all around the world to a whole lot of different places. Yeah. Are you excited for that? Because I saw it was it ends in November of next year. So that is a trek, my friend. That is, yeah, like you end at the O2 Arena and then you end in Birmingham.
And that might not be the very end.
Wow. Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah. No, do you know what? I've been waiting for these moments for so long, yeah, to be on tour. And they're the moments as an artist, and especially when you're in the studio writing the songs, you know, it's super, you get a real sense of fulfillment in those creative spaces when you do something good, of course.
Yeah.
But nothing compares with those live moments. So once I'd kind of got the first tour out of the way, the first thing I said to my manager was, like, let's get back out on the road as quick as we can, because I wanted to keep up this momentum. I could feel something happening at the shows, and the shows were getting bigger and bigger, and the energy was getting more and more. So just about kind of doubling down on that, really, and just going for it.
And last few questions I want to ask you. The big one I'll start with, but for someone that's kind of seen so much, done so much, and has achieved something that a lot of people, I feel like, consider success.
I hope so.
What is success in your mind, and how do you grapple with that?
I think success is individual to everyone, how you interpret it. And I think how I interpreted success, you know, 10 years ago when I was in the band was probably in a different way, you know, because again, that's all I knew, really. So I think it took me a second to work out what that word meant to me, coming out of One Direction and having my solo career. Because I'm lucky enough to have, you know, have achieved so much with the band. It was about, you know, finding something else. And where I found my benefit and where I feel my own success is when I listen back to this record, and it's an album that I really wanted to make. And, you know, the bottom line is, of course, I hope it does well commercially. Mm-hmm. But the feeling of that kind of personal success and kind of knowing what I've come up against at times, that's what makes me feel good, man, definitely.
Yes, definitely. Because, I mean, it is a work of music, a body of art. It's a release.
Yeah. Definitely, right? Mm-hmm. And I really needed to... I always wanted to write this album, you know. I always knew that in the back of my mind, this is the kind of album that I wanted to make. So to be sat here now with those feelings, it just gives me a lot of confidence for what's to come, really.
Yeah. And some few other questions, because I did have some people drop into our show yesterday.
Right.
And they were like, where's Louis? And I was like, he's tomorrow, everybody.
Oh, right. Nice, nice.
But I hope they're back today, because they did ask me to ask you a few things. The things they were very interested in are what artists that you really admire nowadays. I think, you know, there's historically like artists that you've loved, of course, but nowadays, is there anybody that you look at and you're like, oh man, they're doing such cool stuff?
Yeah, there's a few, man. I'm lucky enough to have a lot of them have actually supported me on tour. But so this English band called Stone, that the first time I heard them on track, I was blown away. And the first time I saw them live, they're on a different level, basically. They're unbelievable. I'd say Stone, English band, Inhaler, also really good.
Oh yeah.
The Snuts, who did a lot of touring with me, they're amazing. Their debut record was amazing. Follow-up was unbelievable. Who else am I listening to at the moment? Probably those three. I haven't got around to listening to new Arctic Monkeys record yet, but yeah, those three.
Cool. And last thing, you got your show tomorrow at Irving Plaza. Are you excited about that? Tell me what's going through your mind about playing in New York.
Yeah, I'm really excited. Again, because I've had such a busy year of touring, you know, I think it's only maybe 6 weeks or 2 months. My timekeeping is fucking shit.
I'm sure.
You know, it's not been that long since I've done a show, but it feels like ages. Mm-hmm. So I'm really, really excited to A, get out and perform again, and B, like, you know, bring out these new songs from Faith in the Future and see how they go down.
Yeah, well, Louis, I wish you the best of luck with the shows coming
up. Thank you.